Hi and welcome back to another episode of the Greatest Book Club in the World, the AK Book Club. Yay! And today we are on episode number 65. And you know what it means? It means this is the last episode of the week. And you know what time it is? Khabib time, no? Shout out to Khabib. Khabib Nurmagomedov. But no, this is the binge watch time, yay! Which means we are, as we are as a traditional, it's a true book club readers, book club members. We are going to binge watch the whole AK Book Club channel from episode number one, the historical episode that started this all. So it's the start this all movement from the beginning until episode number 65, which is the most updated episode until now. And yeah, that's what's up. That is what we are going to do. To binge watch over and over and over and over, we are going to make a binge watch party. Bigger than Tomorrowland, we are going to bring everyone that we know, and they are going to bring everyone they know, and their friend, and the friend of the friend, and the friend of the friend and friend, and so on, so on, so on, so on. We're going to biggest to make it the biggest event, not past not after the coronavirus, but the biggest event in human history that ever exists. We are going to make it so big. Why, damn. We are going to make it like the biggest thing in the world, in the history. Yeah. That's what's up. And if you are new to the channel, welcome. And if you are only familiar with the channel, welcome back. My name is Zeki and I'm your host. And with this channel, we are working together on an English and on our ability to communicate well through the camera. Because I truly believe that English is the number one tool that which each one of us must acquire in order to be successful. And the second thing is to communicate well through the camera, because I truly believe that if you know how to communicate well through the camera, you can connect with almost everyone around the world. And it is amazing. It is amazing skill to have if you want to be successful. And you probably want to be successful because this is why you are on this channel. Because on this channel, we are talking about motivation, inspiration, self-development, human psychology, business, entrepreneurship, and so on. And we are learning together tools that are going to make us a better person, a better human being, and a better businessman and woman, and leaders. And if you want to see my samurai friend, please don't cut me down. Don't cut me down. If you're going to cut me through the episode, please let me know so I can protect myself. Can't move. I got this crazy karate move. And if you want to check him out, you can find him on Good Fun. You got the description to it in the link. You got the link to it in the description below. A great site where I find all my backgrounds until now. And I just love this site and a lot of great backgrounds. So make sure to check him out and leave a thumb up and like and a nice comment for the artists that make this a nice samurai. And again, if you want to cut me, because he's a dangerous guy, let me know. And today we are continuing our journey with Simon Sinek. You see it? You got the name of the book right here. Start with Why by Simon Sinek. That book talks about how to influence people and how to communicate well with people. And how to, to communicate our cause and our beliefs to people. And how to inspire the people to work with us on our cause. And to achieve a bigger picture and a bigger cast than each one of our ourselves. I think you can speak it in English. And on our next episode, we learned the importance of to share your trust, to share your why with your employees in the company. And this is, we speak for the last few episodes. Honestly, this bold book is repeating on himself. He says, start with why it's important, we got it. If you want to communicate well with people are connected with your why, not with your what you're doing, but with your why, because if you are sharing the same why, we can work together. If you just want what you want to do, there is no relationship between us. And he just gave us a lot of example around the subject, but in the same principle, start with why and continue from there. Why, what, and how. Why are you doing it? Because I truly believe that English is the number one tool if it requires if you want to be successful. What I'm doing, I'm working on my English each day. And this when I hope to inspire the people to work on solid in English. And I'm doing it by podcasting, by making five episodes per week on my channel to make sure that I'm working on my English. And on the days that I'm not making a podcast, I'm still doing English in my house. Because, you know, each one of us needs to take some time for himself and to relax. And I found for myself that five episodes is a sweet spot. It's a lot of episodes, but it's not too much. So I have my time for myself. And I like it this way. So stand with why. We finished on episode 64 with the example of the babysitter that we would prefer to take a babysitter for children from our community rather than take a babysitter with a much bigger resume from other communities because we don't know where and we think that we don't share the same values as the babysitter from our own community, even though we don't know the babysitter from our own community as well. So, Stand With Why by Simon Sinek, page number 114. Wow. Guys, 114, it's a lot of pages. Read by the one and only, the best leader in the world. The man himself, the man that started his own movement. The legend. You know who he is. And if you know now. AK! The AK himself. You know, that's what's up. That's what's up. When you got your own podcast, when you got your own show, you can say whatever you want. So Stand With Why, my same thing by AK himself. Page number 114. Historically, trust has played a bigger role in advancing companies and societies than skill set alone. Like the couple leaving their children while they go out on a date for the evening. Groups from within a society would go off with confidence, knowing that their homes and families would be safe upon their return. If there were no trust, then no one would take risks. No risks would mean no exploration. No experimentation. And no advancement of the society as a whole. That is a remarkable concept. Only when individuals can trust the culture or organization, will they take personal risks in order to advance that culture or organization as a whole. For no other reason, in the end, it is good for their own personal health and survival. No matter how experienced, no matter how proficient a trapeze artist will not attempt a totally new defining leap without first trying it with a net below him. And depending on how defining the trick is, he might insist on always having a net when performing the trick. Besides its obvious advantage of catching you if you fall, the net also provides a psychological benefit. Knowing it is there gives a trapeze artist the confidence to try something he has never done before, or to do it again and again. Remove the net and they will only do the safe tricks. The safe tricks. The ones they know he can land. The more he trusts the quality of the net, the more he will take personal risks to make his act better. The trust the circus management gives him by providing him a net is probably afforded to other performers too. Soon all the performers will feel confident to try new things and push themselves further. That collection of personal confidence and personal risk resulting in the entire circus putting on a much better show. An overall better show means more customers. And the systems thrive. And the system thrive. THRIVES. But not without trust. For those within a community or an organization, they must trust that their leaders provide an innate practical or emotional. With that feeling of support, those in the organization are more likely to put in extra effort that ultimately benefits the group as a whole. I will admit that there are always those who will take the risk. For the first time or repeatedly, without the net, there will always be those who will explore regardless of who is on holding down the fort. Those people sometimes earn their rightful spot as the innovators. The ones who pushed further. The ones who did things no one else would do. The ones who did things no one else would do. Some of them might advance a business or even society. And some of them end up dead before they achieve anything. There is a big difference between jumping out a plane with a parachute on and jumping without one. And you know this guy, the jump from 7 kilometers with no parachute to a small net. You can watch it on YouTube. Both produce extraordinary experiences. But only one increases the likelihood of being able to try again another time. A trapeze artist with a personality predisposed to taking extraordinary risks without a net, might be the star attraction in an otherwise mediocre show. But if he dies or leaves for another circus, then what? This is the paradigm in which someone is motivated by self-gain regardless of the consequences or the benefits to the organization for which he or she works. In such a case, the effort might be good for the individual and it might be good for the group, but the benefits, especially for the group, come with a time limit. Over time, the system will break down, often to the detriment of the organization. Developing trust to encourage people other than those with a predilection for risk, like Nick Leeson, is a better long-term strategy. Great organizations become great because the people inside the organization feel protected. The strong sense of culture creates a sense of belonging and acts like a net. People come to work knowing that their bosses, colleagues, and the organization as a whole will look out for them. This results in reciprocal reciprocal behavior. Individuals, decisions, efforts, and behaviors that support, benefit, and protect the long-term interest of the organization as a whole. Southwest Airlines, a company renowned for its customer focus, does not, as a matter of policy, believe the customer is always right. Southwest will not tolerate customers who abuse their staff. They would rather those customers fly on a different airline. It is a subtle irony that one of the best customer service companies in the country focused on its employees before its customers. The trust between the management and the employees, not dogma, is what produces the great customer service. It is a pre-requested request PREQUISITE, then for someone to trust the culture in which they work, to share the values and beliefs of that culture. Without it, that employee, for example, is simply a bad fit and likely to work only for self-gain without consideration for the greater good. For the greater good. But if those inside the organization are a good fit, the opportunity to go the extra mile, to explore, to invent, to innovate, to advance, and more importantly, to do so again and again and again, increases dramatically. Only with a mutual trust can an organization become great. Title: Real trust comes from the things you can see. Real trust comes from the things you can see. Number two, said the voice over Barry Gander, General Jumper's radio, referring to him by his call sign. Your group 180, 25 miles, closing fast. Bernie Yard, radar contact, replied number two, reporting that he had picked up the enemy group on his own radar. A one-star general, John Jumper, was an experienced F-15 pilot with thousands of hours of flight time and over a thousand combat hours. By all measures, he was one of the best. Born in Paris, Texas. You got Paris in Texas? Damn! It can be fun if you book a flight to Paris instead of the famous Paris in French, you land in Paris, Texas. Close your eyes and damn, where am I? US. It can be a funny thing. Born in Paris, Texas, Dame, he had enjoyed a distinguished career. He had flown just about everything the US Air Force had, from cargo planes to fighter jets. Decorated and distinguished as a commander of his own combat wing, he was an embodiment of what it means to be a fighter pilot, smart and confident. But on that day, Jumper's reaction didn't match the situation he faced. By 25 miles, he would have been expected to fire his weapons or take some other offensive movement. Fearing that Jumper was locked onto the wrong contact, on his radar, Captain Laurie Robinson calmly repeated what she could see from miles away. Rambo 2 confirmed radar contact. Your group now 180 and 90. Your group now 190, 20 miles. As the air weapons controller who was watching the action on a radar screen from a nearby command and control center, it was Lori Robinson's job to direct the pilot over the enemy aircraft so that he could use his weapons to intercept and destroy them. Unlike an air traffic controller, whose job it is to keep air traffic apart. The weapons controller has to bring the planes closer together. From the vantage point of the radar screen, only the weapons controller has a big picture. As the pilots on board the navigation system shows only what is directly in front of the aircraft. Captain Robinson saw her job as something bigger, however, than just staring at radar. Something more profound than just being the eyes and the Indians for the pilots who were entering into arms away at 1,500 miles per hour. That's fast. Captain Robinson knew why her job was important. It's fast, but it's not as fast as this channel is growing up. Guys, you're going to be the biggest channel in the world. Then you're going to pass Joe Rogan and PewDiePie and these things together, combined. Captain Robinson knew why her job was important. She saw herself as responsible for clearing a path for the pilots, in her care so that they could do what they needed to do, so they could push themselves and the aircraft further with greater confidence. And for this reason, she was unusually good at her job. Robinson couldn't make mistakes. If she did, she would lose the trust of her pilots, and once they would lose trust in themselves. You see, it is confidence that makes makes fighter pilots so good at their jobs. And then it happened. Captain Robinson could tell from the calm of Jumper's voice over the radio that he was unaware of the threat coming at him. On a cloudless day, 20,000 feet over the desert, the alarm screeched, S-C-A-R-E-C-H-E-D, in Rambo 2's $25 million, state-of-the-art fighter jet. He looked up from his radar screen, and saw the enemy engaging him. "Break right, break right," he screamed into his radio. On October 9, 1988, Brigadier General John R. Jumper was killed. Said name. Rest in peace. Captain Robinson waited. There was an E-R-I-E, calm. Before too long, Jumper stormed into the briefing room at Nellis Air Force Base. "You got me killed," he barked at Captain Robinson. Situated in the Nevada desert. Nellis is home to the Air Force Fighter Weapons School. And on that day, General John Jumper took a direct hit from a simulated missile from another U.S. Air Force jet plane as a part of an enemy combatant. Sir, it was not my fault, Captain Robinson replied. "Call me. Check the video. You will see. General Jumper, the 57th Wing Commander, a gratitude of the USAF, USAF, Fighter Weapons School, and a former instructor at Nellis, urgently elevated every detail of every training mission he flew. Pilots often relied on the video to learn from their exercises. The video didn't lie, and it didn't on the day either. It revealed that the error was indeed not Captain Robinson's. It was a classic blunder. He had forgotten he was part of a team. He had forgotten that what made him so good at his job was not just his ability, but was not just his ability. Jumper was one of the best because there were others who were looking out for him. A massive infraction, a massive infrastructure of people he couldn't see. Without question, General Jumper had been given the best equipment, the best technology, and the best training that money could buy. But it was the mechanics, the teachers, his fellow pilots, and the culture of the Air Force and Captain Robinson who ensured that he could trust himself to get the job done. General Jumper forgot why he was so good and made a split-second decision that cost him his life. But this is what training is for, to learn these lessons. So guys, this was the episode of today. The episode of the week, and I'm leaving you today. I finished this episode today because I want to give you, to keep you curious about what is going to become next with Captain, what is the name, with General Jumper, Captain General Jumper, and Captain Robinson. What is the next for the episode to be continued on Sunday? So guys, thank you very much for joining me. We continue to learn the importance of why. I think it's going to be this way to the end of the book, repeating why it's important, with a lot of great example. I enjoyed it. I learned history and I learned example. And I put it deeper in my mind. The more you repeat a thing, the more it gets in your mind. I get it more in my mind. Why is important? So guys, thank you very much for joining me. It's time for Binge Watch the Whole AK Channel. From episode one, the episode that started this whole, the start this whole movement, until episode number 65, the latest episode that released. So guys, thank you very much for joining me. Enjoy your watch time, binge watch with your family, friends and neighborhood. And remember, we are going to make this channel the biggest channel in the world. We are going to make this binge watch party, the biggest binge watch parties of the world. So stay safe, stay home, and this is coronavirus. It's best us. Have a great time with your family, friends, neighborhoods, and on this weekend. And just about the binge watch team, the binge watch parties. And I hope to see you all on Sunday for the next episode to continue the story of General Jumper and Captain Robinson, and continue our journey together of improving our English and our skills and ability to communicate well through the camera. So see you on Sunday. Until then, have a great time. Take care and bye-bye.